There. So welcome to week number four of a series we're calling Reinvent. Everyone say reinvent. And the premise of this series is that if we want God to reinvent certain areas of our lives, we need to let Him reinvent who we are as a person. You can't affect this area or that area or that area just by saying, God, fix this, but don't fix me. That doesn't work that way, right? It's like when you want your marriage to be transformed, you can't say, fix them. You got to say, God, fix me. You know, because we're the one that can change, work on ourselves. We can't do it without God's power, but we're the one that can be impacted by that. And so when one of the things that God does when He reinvents us is He gives us purpose. Everyone say purpose. And so we have what we call a growth track, and we've reimagined it several times over the last several years. But right now it's a two-step process available right after service today for step one. And then next week after service, you can take step two. And the purpose of growth track is to help you take steps into discovering your purpose. When you know how you're made, when you know how you're wired, you know the things that God's already put on the inside of you, you'll begin to get an idea of how you are created to function in the earth and for the purpose that God has for you. And so here's the thing. I have good news and I have bad news today. The bad news is Jesus said, in this life you will have trouble. The good news part of that is He said, I've overcome the world. All right, but there's some more bad news. Even though you keep having problems, you can get all weighed down by them and overwhelmed by them. But the challenge is to find a purpose greater than your problems. And when you find that purpose, it'll get you up out of bed in the morning. You'll know you're doing something for God. And that's why we do Growth Track. So you don't even have to sign up today. Just show up in the Connect Room off the hallway, and you can really just begin to take that journey with us. All right, you ready to dive in? And so let's begin with our series verse in this Reinvent series. Romans 12:2 says, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. We think... changing the way you act, but it's changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. So the way that God transforms us is we've got to give Him permission to change how we think. And of course, we've got to cooperate with Him, because every one of us have some stinking thinking. You can feel free to turn to somebody you know really well. Don't turn the other way. And just say, yeah, that's you, right? It's okay, right? So there's areas where our thinking, what we think is true, what we see as fact, is in reality messing up our own lives. Because we've got some stinking thinking in that area. And one of those areas is relationships. Relationships. And so I think the devil does some of his most destructive work in our lives through relationships. Think about your own life for a moment. Maybe there was a father who abused or neglected you. A mom who was critical or said hurtful things with her words. Maybe you have mean siblings. I've got an amen there, I think. Some of you have had schoolmates, classmates who bullied you, right? Others, you have people that in your life, you gossip. Some of you had church hurt. We've all had all kinds of things happen in our life through relationships. And yet God's plan is for you to have the right kind of relationships in your life, because when you do, they move you forward. They move you forward in your life. Relationships actually have the power to transform who we are as people. My Labor Day project. How many of you had a Labor Day project? Some of you said, no, I rested. Well, I had a Labor Day project, and I went through a 5-drawer file cabinet. You say, yeah, I was a glutton for punishment. That I hadn't been through in 20 years. And there was some things that, there was things that were actively used, but there's things that just had been in there. And so in the process of going through that, I just was reminded of some of the people that had impacted my life. I realized that I had kept some notes and cards going back about 20 years. And so there's a few of them that I kept, but most of them I was like, I can't hold on to this anymore, right? Right? But one of the things I noticed is where I had a document in there where I'd written out 10 things that my grandma Bartsch, some stories where she had impacted my life. So I think it was probably for her funeral, but I found that. I found notes maybe written by some of you, some going back 15 to 20 years, and they deeply encouraged me. I saw articles that my mom had clipped out of the local newspaper back when I was in high school and played varsity basketball. I mean, this file had some stuff in it, right? Yep. And I found a history of the church that I grew up in, which, by the way, was founded out of a small group in 1875 and lasted over 100 years, 100 and some years, in a small town. I was like, man, I thought about the people. There was photographs of those who were there towards the end and people that had impacted my life. And I thought, I have been impacted by some incredible people, although imperfect. I think it's a lot has to do with our perspective. And you know, one of the things that the Bible, especially the New Testament, talks a lot about is one another's. And so when I was going through that file cabinet, I saw that there was a lot of one another's. And in the Greek in the New Testament, that word means one another, each other. And this is the part I really love. And it'll be a kind of set us off where we're going for today. Mutually. Reciprocally. All right? That's what it means. In fact, that Greek word there, alanon, is used over 100 times in the New Testament. One another, one another, one another. All these things. For example, we're not going to go through all 100, so you can just praise the Lord right there. It might be good, though. That'd be a whole series, right? John 13:34, Jesus said, "So now I'm giving you a new commandment, love each other. Just as I have loved you, you should love each other." That's a pretty high bar, right? Your love for one another, I love this, will prove to the world that you're my disciples. So what does the enemy attack with? He's trying to destroy the love that Christians, believers, should have between one another. He's always trying to get in the middle. He's always working on that. So I have a PD paraphrase, Pastor Doug paraphrase. PD paraphrase is want to stand out, love other believers so well that it is noticeable to society. That was kind of Jesus' standard. Amen? But you know what the problem is? So many of us, we just feel like relationships are just exhausting. Oh, can't handle that. We're like Legos. We got about 8 slots, and then we can't handle one more on that. You know, we're just about done. And the issue is we have relationship fatigue. I want to talk about why we have relationship fatigue for just a moment. One of the reasons, and I'm just going to go there this morning, so y'all just buckle your seatbelts for a minute, open your hearts, but the first thing is we stay offended. We stay offended. Offended means to be resentful or annoyed. Everybody pull your toes back under your seats real quick. We're going to walk all over those aisles. Typically, as a result of a perceived, it doesn't even have to be a real insult, it's a perceived insult, right? Regardless of what caused it, you're resentful, you're indignant, and what goes through your mind is, I just can't believe they. And you finish whatever they did. You're just, you're offended. Now, Luke 17:1, Jesus said to the disciples, it is impossible that no offenses should come, but woe to him through whom they do come. I mean, you're going to get opportunity to be offended at least once a day, maybe once an hour, once a minute. I mean, it's going to happen, right? They'll give you opportunities to be offended all day long. So I've made this verse one of my life verses, Psalm 119:165. Out of the King James says, great peace have they which love thy law. In other words, God, I value your law and what you say more than what everybody else says. And therefore, nothing shall offend me. That's a high standard. I'm not perfect in it, but that's my goal. Just have a thick skin and a tender heart, right? Just let that stuff run off of me. And so here's the thing. When you value what God says more than when you value what others say, it's easier not to get offended. Now, Jesus dealt with people who were offended at him all the time. I mean, that was his ministry, right? One of the groups that were offended by him was his hometown. I mean, the hometown. They knew him before. Now, the biggest people that have problem with you is they knew you before. before Jesus got a hold of you in that area of life, or before you gave your life to Jesus, right? And the Bible says they were deeply offended. Now, here's the problem with being offended. Matthew 13, 57 says they were deeply offended and refused to believe in him. And so he did only a few miracles there because of their unbelief. The more offended you are, the more it's an indication of how high your unbelief is. Ooh, I got faith. But if you're offended, you don't have faith. At least not towards that person. Because when you're offended at so-and-so, and half of you in here had a picture, a name come up in your head. When you're offended at them, you can't receive from them. You just talk to the hand. You know, remember when that went around? I don't want to hear from you, right? Yeah, so you've got to be careful about being offended. It'll actually stop God from doing miracles in your life. You can pray and be offended over there, but Jesus, another command, I give you a new command, love one another as I've loved you. And in your offense and in my offense, when we get offended, we violate that command. And we wonder why God isn't working in our life. And so, what we do when we're offended is we write people off. Thank God he doesn't write us off. Man, he could have been offended at me. Probably could have been offended at you. But he wasn't. He did the total opposite. He went and died for us on the cross for our sins. And so there's another relationship pitfall, and it's closely tied to it. And that's a relationship fatigue causer is really unforgiveness. Sometimes we've been so hurt, so offended, that we just simply refuse to forgive. And we stay in, just like we stay in offense, we stay in this unforgiveness. And so some of us are thinking, well, when they apologize, I'll forgive. What if they never apologize? Some of us say, well, when they change, I'll forgive. What if they never change? What are we going to do then? So are you going to stay in unforgiveness? Because here's the problem. When you're offended, it leads to unforgiveness. And when you get into unforgiveness, eventually, if you stay there, it'll lead to bitterness. And bitterness will poison and destroy relationships. And it'll actually poison and destroy the future that God intended for you to have. Because you got over into that. Ever met a hard, bitter person? You'll know it before you even get close to them. Because they're already pushing you away. They got their walls up, their barriers, they're you know, the moat, they pulled the moat up. They're not letting anybody around the castle, right? So here's the thing. What removes offense? What removes and transforms unforgiveness and prevents bitterness? The cure is to forgive quickly. Quickly. Don't stay there. Get that forgiven quickly. And here's what will help you. Forgiveness is not a feeling. You may never feel like forgiving. That may never come. So you decide based on what Jesus did for you. If he forgave me, then I can forgive them. Why? Because it's not your whatever, you know, your little bottle of forgiveness that does it. It's from him that you're pouring out to somebody else. Amen? And so forgive. Here's what Mark 11, 25 says. Jesus said this, that whenever you stand praying, like, God, I have faith. I'm believing for this miracle. If you have anything against anyone, forgive him or her. That your Father in heaven may also forgive you your trespasses. That's a pretty big deal. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father in heaven forgive your trespasses. So let me ask it this way. When you get to heaven, what's going to be on your account? Because if you're holding on to it, it's still on your account. Should we just end right here with an altar call and forgiveness? Here's another problem with being offended and staying offended and staying in unforgiveness. It causes you to miss out on the power of life-giving relationships. You just stay away from it all. So if you're trying to eliminate the risk of getting hurt, you can't. That risk will always be there. So, you know, some of the worst hurt in my life came through relationships. Well, some of it, you know, I don't have time to talk about it, but, you know, dating relationships that ended. You know, I knew I was going to marry that person, but it ended. I mean, I was the one that ended it, but it still hurt. Right? Thank God. I got an upgrade. Right? You know, got Kim. Amen? But here's the thing. If if I'd have stayed hurt and stayed I'm not going to ever do. Actually, I did say that a month before I met Kim. I said, Lord, if I need to be single the rest of my life, I don't want to go through that again. A month later, I met Kim. But if you don't try again, you'll never know. You know, people have gossiped, people have lied about me. But if you begin to pour your life out and continue to pour your life out, you're going to pour your life. I've poured my life into some amazing people who did not walk away from God, and they're staying firm with God and they're living for Him. That's rewarding. That's rewarding. Amen. So you can try this: return good for evil. I like it straight out of the Bible. I don't even have to make this stuff up. Return good for evil. If you want to avoid the rush hour traffic, take the high road. There's not much traffic there. They're just not going to have an issue with that. So I'm so glad I did that, because there's incredible power in the right kind of relationships. Let me give you a few things real quick. First of all, agreement. When we agree with other believers on God's word, literally, we can help bring to pass what God's will is in heaven on earth. Here's what Matthew 18, 19, and 20 says. I tell you this, if two of you agree here on earth concerning anything you ask, my Father in heaven will do it for you. For where there are two or three gathered together in, as my followers, I am there among them. Amen. We agree on God's word, not just what we want, right? That's the unwritten thing here. But God responds to you and a couple friends praying and agreeing in alignment with the word of God. Kim can tell you this. She can verify this. Is we ask each other all the time, what are we agreeing on? Or my favorite question, are we in agreement? You know, because just because we talked about it doesn't mean we're in agreement, right? You got to know, is this the decision? Are we in agreement here, you know? Because there's something that happens when you formally declare, this is our agreement. This is what we're agreeing on according to God's word. And so it's a big thing. And I think it's an area that most couples probably miss it. We talk, but we don't actually say we're agreeing on what the word says here. We're going to stand on this word together. So agreement. Here's another one. We talked about this a few weeks ago, but I want to just come at it a little differently today. Spiritual gifts. We miss out on the power of relationships. And one of those things is spiritual gifts, because spiritual gifts can be discovered through relationships, but they also a place for us to use relationships. God gave you some spiritual gifts so that you can use them. And so here's a couple we don't talk about a lot. I just wanted to highlight them because they're real. 1 Corinthians 12:7-8. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one of us for the profit of all. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit. So it's not just being smart and having wisdom. Let me give you the definitions. A word of wisdom is supernatural wisdom from God spoken that you then speak into another person's life. A word of knowledge is supernatural ability by the Holy Spirit to know facts about a situation or person that could not be known by natural means. It's a gift of the Spirit. Often these two gifts work together. And the Lord uses them, the Holy Spirit uses them to build up other people, to help people come to understanding about certain things in their life that they may have been blind to. But it's in the context of relationship. Yesterday during our prayer gathering that we had, I just happened to notice one particular woman was praying over another woman, and I thought, that's awesome, that's great, you know, wonderful thing. And I just happened after it was over to be standing in the back, and that same woman came and spoke some things into the other woman, probably not knowing it, but really using these gifts. And it was an encouragement, it was a blessing. And so, actually, I've realized in the last few years that this is an area that God's used me more and more over the last few years. And people that I've used, not used that gift on, but God's used me with that gift, they don't even know what's going on. They didn't recognize it because they don't make it weird. I just let God work. But your spiritual gifts are made to be worked out in the context of relationships. And in fact, if you think you have a spiritual gift and you really don't, relationships will let you know. They'll let you know. Amen? So without godly relationships, you're missing out on that. Here's something else you'll miss out on. Motivation. Now, the best motivation is intrinsic. But how all of us need somebody to come along and say, hey, you're going to make it. You know, you might say that's encouragement, but we need others encouraging us. Here's what Hebrews 10:24 says, but let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. So what have you been thinking about lately? Probably not this. Let us think. Like when you're sitting around, how can I motivate and provoke others to love and good works? That'll cure a lot of those thought issues you've been having. Because here's the thing. When we go through a problem, what do we think about? My problem. And the more you think about your problem, does it get bigger? Yeah. We read a verse yesterday in the prayer gathering out of, I think, 2 Corinthians. But there's battles outside, and then you know it's serious when it becomes fears inside. And that'll happen through thinking. But when you're thinking of how can I provoke somebody else to love and good works, changes the whole thing. Changes everything. Big thing. Verse 25, and let us not neglect our meeting together. Y'all are doing it. So you're here. I'm proud of you. As some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of his return is drawing near. So you say, Pastor, y'all send out so many emails. We send out one a week. You should be checking your email and reading them. Keeps you informed. And there's a reason we send out texts every Saturday to remind you of something on Sunday, because you may not have a person that says, hey, I'll see you in church on Sunday. And I want to be that person. And you may say, well, it is one text from us to many people. But here's the thing about it. Those texts are answered personally. I see those texts, or our team sees, you know, they do some things on there, but most of those I see and respond to. And so it's a personal thing, but it helps us stay. If no one else will be your encourager, I want to be your encourager. I want to say, come on, let's serve Jesus together. Amen. Let's go for God together. Amen. Yeah, give Jesus a hand clap. Amen. But what's even better is when you got a friend that'll say, hey, I'll see you in group this week, or I'll see you at church next Sunday. You know, you're going to be there? Hey, get your lazy butt out of bed and come on, let's go. Did I say that out loud? You know, come on, because your friend can talk to you like that. Pastor will say, please get up kindly and you know, make your way to church. But your friend can tell you, they know you, right? Yeah. We all need that. Here's something else that we get out of friendships, great, great value, is partnership. The Old Testament calls it covenant. And it's really when you form this lifelong bond with another person. It's not sexual. It's a commitment to one another. Now, marriage is one form of that covenant, but it also can be between friends. And that the power of that particular relationship can save your life. In fact, it can have influence beyond your life. In the Old Testament, in 1 Samuel, Jonathan was the son of King Saul. And David, he was the one that had killed Goliath, and he was God's chosen to be the king. But Jonathan was the rightful heir to the throne. And yet, in spite of that, Jonathan and David both knew that God was giving David the throne. And David and Jonathan had this unique love and concern for one another, so that they actually made a covenant. We read it in 1 Samuel 20, verse 14. And this is what they were saying. And you may treat me with the faithful love, and may you treat me with the faithful love of the Lord as long as I live. But if I die, treat my family with this faithful love. Even when the Lord destroys all your, and this is Jonathan, even when the Lord destroys all your enemies from the face of the earth. He's saying, remember my family. So Jonathan made a solemn pact or covenant with David, saying, may the Lord destroy all your enemies. That was David's response to Jonathan. And Jonathan made David reaffirm his vow of friendship again, for Jonathan loved David as he loved himself. You're not going to have a lot of these. But you're not going to know which ones can become this unless you have enough friends to kind of have some friendships, and some will develop to a higher level. Amen? It's a close friendship. You won't have many, like I said, but God used this relationship to save David from Jonathan's dad, the king, Saul. Spared his life because of that. And later, when Jonathan and Saul were killed in battle, after some time passed, David showed kindness to his family because of that covenant. So you miss out on that when you're not in relationship. And so these are the kind of relationships that really help each other serve God fully. It's a wonderful thing. So today I want to encourage you with four things on how to reinvent your relationships. Are you ready for these? Here's number one. add value before expecting value. That's the big one. Too often we set ourselves up for relationship fatigue through offense, through unforgiveness, and we get to even those places by having expectations of getting value before giving value. Okay? And so we're like, well, what's in it for me? It's real self, and that's a selfish way to go about being in a relationship. And here's the thing, the value you and I bring to a relationship is not determined by us. It's determined by the other person in the relationship. They decide if you're adding value. You say, well, I've been adding value, and they just don't get it. Well, then you haven't been adding value the way they like to have value added. Have you ever heard, like, in the five love languages? You know, you may be acts of service as one of your things in your marriage. You're just serving your spouse, and you get no credit. But their love language is words of affirmation, and you're talking ugly to them. Your account just went empty. No matter how many times you mow the lawn and how you zigzag it and how, you know, it doesn't matter. You're not speaking their language. So the other person determines the value. So you got to remember that. Always add value before you expect value. It's a great leadership principle, by the way. And then have an expectation and a goal to add value to the other person's life. Here's the key. No strings attached. Because if we go, well, I did that for them, then what you're doing is keeping score. And when you're keeping score, you're always going to be on the losing end of the score. You just never win that way. So you can't keep score. You just got to, true God kind of love, that unfailing, that God kind of love, that agape love, just gives without expecting anything in return. That's the way Jesus loves us. He gives us an opportunity of relationship, but he knows that many people won't choose it. And yet he gives it. Same thing in relationships. Matthew 20:26 says, but among you it will be different. Whoever wants to be a leader among you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first among you must become your slave. We think about this in leadership terms, but it says, for even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve others and to give his life as a ransom for many. Another verse, it's in your notes, but I'm not going to go through it. It's Luke 6:38. Give, it says, and you shall receive. Give, and you shall receive. So you got to put something in before you get something out. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. All of that verse doesn't apply until you put something in. So here's my PD paraphrase. I'm on PD paraphrases today. Whoever wants to benefit in a relationship must first serve others in that relationship. So ask yourself, how am I adding value to my family, to my spouse, even to you that are serving on Dream Team? How are you adding value to your fellow Dream Teamers? How about this one? How are you adding value to your parents, to your siblings? Oh, siblings, that'd be a good one. Just camp on that one for a while. All the parents said, yeah, that's right. Amen. So yeah, we've got to add value before we expect value. And here, just go ahead and tuck your toes under your chair right now. We're coming for number two. Develop your EQ. You know what your EQ is? Your emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence. What's EQ? It's your emotional and relational intelligence. So the question is, how relationally intelligent are you? See, you can have high IQ, like you do great in your school, your book learning, all that's real high. But if you have low EQ, low relational intelligence, it's going to hinder your career. It's going to hinder your family because, you know, you're the person that says the wrong thing at the wrong time. You're not aware of what's going on around you. And, you know, the relationships. Amen. I got quiet in here. So let me just write from the Bible because EQ is all over in the Bible. Let me just, what do I mean? Simple things like, first of all, listen before speaking. No, you didn't hear me. You didn't hear me. They've done studies, and studies show that most people listen to respond. They don't listen to understand. So if you're like you're in an argument going back and forth, you're just going to let the first half of the sentence come out. And as soon as that comes out, you've already made up your mind of what you're going to say. And you're reframing your argument because, well, get him. No. Listen before speaking. Proverbs 18, 13. Listen before you answer. I mean, you can't make this stuff up. It's right in the Bible. If you don't, you're being stupid and insulting. Have you ever answered the wrong question? Here's another one. Don't meddle in other people's business. Proverbs 26, 17, getting involved in an argument that is none of your business is like going down the street and grabbing a dog by the ears. What happens when you grab a dog by the ears? You get bit. What happens when you get involved in relationships that you don't, or dealing with something that you don't know firsthand how it happened? You get bit. People come to me sometimes, they say, Pastor, they... My first question is, who's they? Well, you know they, which usually means it's them. That's the way I, just so you know your pastor, that's the way I read them. It's you and somebody you were talking with. Tell me what you were thinking. And then they want me to go do something that I don't know nothing about just because they're telling me. I don't get involved in that. Just let God work that out. If I start doing that, I'd have all kinds of bite marks all over me. I want to live long. Amen? So... And so this is just a really good verse. And here's the third one. I like this one. Stop dominating the conversation. Pull those toes back. Proverbs 17:27. A truly wise person uses few words. A person with understanding is even-tempered. Even fools are thought wise when they keep silent. With their mouths shut, they seem intelligent. My dad used to say this. And I'm reminded of this often just in my head. Just, you know, these things come up when your dad said it. It is better to be thought a fool than to open your mouth and remove all doubt. Amen. Good statement. Now, you're thinking, well, Pastor, I got words. That's wonderful. You should get some more friends. Because the one friend you got can't handle them all. Right, you just spread a little of them over here, 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 and you'll have more friends for longer. All right? I'm just here to help you, right? Now, I'm not saying this, that you should say this to those of your friends that babble, but there is a verse in the Bible that's very interesting. Job 11:2 says this, shouldn't someone answer this torrent of words? Is a person proved innocent just by a lot of talking? Should I remain silent while you babble on? I just love how the Bible's so real. Now, in the context, that was a bad friend of Job talking to Job. So just let me make that clear, right? But the idea is we just gotta have some relational intelligence. It'll help us to have better friendships. Amen? Oh, that was a little weak. I know, you can put your toes back out. I'll just let the Bible do the work here. Here's the third thing. Third thing that'll really help you reinvent your relationships. Just love well. And I can't say it better than the Bible, or I'm not even going to try to, but I'm just going to read a passage. It's out of Romans 12. It says, don't just pretend to love others. Really love them. Amen. Hate what is wrong. Hold tightly to what is good. Love each other with genuine affection and take delight in honoring each other. Give you a little friendship secret. Ask them about themselves. They'll talk all day. They'll carry the conversation. You'll learn so much. And they'll walk away and say, man, I had a great conversation with that person. Right? You're honoring. And I don't mean it in a manipulative way, but just you can honor others. That would hear their side. Verse 11, never be lazy, but work hard and serve the Lord enthusiastically. 12, rejoice in our confident hope. Be patient in trouble. What do we usually do in trouble? We give up. Oh, God's mad at me. No, he says, keep on praying. 13, when God's people are in need, be ready to help them. Always be eager to practice hospitality. 14, here we go. Bless those who persecute you. Don't curse them. How many of that, just let's have honesty, how many of that's been a challenge at times? Oh, yeah, I got both hands up. Come on. Pray that God will bless them. Wow. 15, be happy with those who are happy and weep with those who weep. 16, live in harmony with each other. Don't be too proud to enjoy the company of ordinary people. We're all ordinary, so I think we're doing good there. And don't think you know it all. 17, never pay back evil with more evil. Do things in such a way that everyone can see that you're honorable. 18, do all that you can to live in peace with everyone. That's a good one. You can't live at peace with everyone, but you can do all that you can do to live at peace with everyone. 19, dear friends, never take revenge. Leave that to the righteous anger of God. Coming back to that theme of forgiveness. So that'll help you a lot. Just love well. There's a lot of things you can do out of there. And then the fourth thing, participate in a fall small group. You knew it was coming. You've been waiting with bated breath. You've been anticipating me saying it. Now the question is, will you do it? Will you do it? Want to make some new friends? Attend a group. Want to practice today's message? Attend a group. Want to tell someone to stop the torrent of words? Attend a group. No, I'm just kidding on that one. Hopefully you don't need to, right? Want someone to pray for you, believe God with you? Attend a group. Amen? So a group is where you go to do all those things, but it's also a place where you can begin to find freedom from the things that are tormenting you. Your battles in life. There's a group of people. It may be the whole group. You don't have to share anything you don't want to. Maybe one or two people, and they will stand with you, and they will pray with you, and they will believe God for that situation or that problem in your life to turn. Amen? Amen. You never have to say more than you want. Just follow God's leading in that. Amen? So here's the next step. Just attend a small group this week. Really, really simple. We have a women's group that begins Tuesday night right here, 7 o'clock. 10:30 Wednesday morning, a women's group meets in the lobby. Go there. Wednesday night, students, 7 o'clock, right here. Thursday night, men meet right here. Just it's so simple. Just find a place. Say, baby, I got the kids on Tuesday night, so you can go, you know, go to the women's, and she'll keep them on Thursday night, and you can come to the men's meeting. Whatever it is, just work together and work it out. I promise you, you will see God do a work in your life. And relationships will become better, and you will become better because you're letting God transform you through relationships. Let's bow our heads in prayer this morning. Father, we just thank you today that you love us so much, that you allow us to have a relationship with you, but also that you allow us to have relationships with each other. And Lord, today I know that I said some strong things. And Lord, I've got my toes curled up too because there were some things I need to work on. But Father, we just come to you today and we say we want to do relationships better. And we want to get past this relational fatigue and just have this flow of your life in our lives. And so Father, I just ask you this morning to help us. Help us to ask you and invite you into our relationships, to listen for your still small voice. For those times that we can just begin to minister encouragement. For those times that we can begin to speak a word of life over someone. Father, we thank you for that. In Jesus' name, with every head bowed, every eye closed. Maybe you're sitting here today and you've missed out on the most important relationship you could ever have. And that's a relationship with Jesus Christ. So this morning, I want to invite you to take a step and put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. He died on the cross for your sins so that you wouldn't have to pay the penalty of those sins by being separated from him for eternity. And so if you want to give your life to Jesus this morning, I want to just invite you to lift up a hand. To say, Pastor, every head bowed, every eye closed, I'm not right with God, but I want to give my life to Jesus. If that's you today, would you lift up your hand? Just hold up your hand. Nobody's going to make you come down front. I see those hands. Nobody's going to ask you to say anything. Thank you for those hands. You can put them down. Let's say this together with those that are making this decision today. And let's believe God for a miracle in our lives. Say this with me. Heavenly Father, I come to you today. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I ask you to make me a new person from the inside out. God, I turn away from that old life. God, I believe Jesus died on the cross for my sins. And that you raised him from the dead. And so Jesus, I ask you to be my Lord. Be my leader. Save me from my sins. In Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Come on, can we celebrate that today?